Hey, Crosspoint family, welcome back to our online service, one of our last few online services. We are gearing back up to meet at the church once again and go back to normal services again. And hey, if you have been watching and have never been a part of our service, but you have been engaged in our online service, hey, we wholeheartedly welcome you and invite you to come join us when we meet back. Be sure to like our Facebook page and be keeping updated with when we're coming back and the things that we're going to be doing a little bit different. But I promise, me and Pastor Matt are a whole lot less awkward in person, and we would love to meet you, and we're super excited to be back with all of you. So hey, let's again engage in a time of worship and thank God for this time to be reflective and have this alone time to really focus in on God and what he's doing in our own personal lives. And so let's just do that. Let's thank him and let's worship him.
Victorious, you are the only king forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only king forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Whoa, whoa. down.
'Cause I'm on top of the world, hey. I'm on top.
We're so proud of our seniors and graduates of 2020. We're going to celebrate you in person as we get back together on June 7th. But I've been watching this documentary on Michael Jordan called The Last Dance. Now, just a disclaimer, this is not a Christian documentary. There's some rough stuff in it. But I wanted to watch it because whenever I was in middle school and in high school, Michael Jordan was the man. He had shoes, commercials, movies, and he could play basketball. In my opinion, he was the GOAT, the greatest of all time. Now, some of you will disagree with that, and that's okay. But I remember in school, so many people wore Michael Jordan attire, whether it was all the Bulls attire as well, shirts and shorts, everything. But why do they love the Chicago Bulls? I grew up in Dallas, and I was like, we had our own basketball team, but everybody wore Chicago Bulls stuff. And it's because that they were following that player, and they had won 3 championships in a row, and then 3 more after Michael had his baseball stint. If you look around today, though, you don't see many people wearing Chicago Bulls attire anymore. And so were they really Chicago fans or just Michael Jordan fans? I like to call them fair weather fans. As long as their player is there or a particular team is winning, they said, I'll be a fan. And we see this now with Tom Brady, who's left the Patriots and now is playing for the Buccaneers, or with LeBron James, started out with the Cavs, then he went to the Heat, then back to the Cavaliers, and now with the Lakers. People jumping wherever the star goes, and they root and they buy attire for wherever their star is or whoever the winning team is. These fair weather fans. You don't see the loyalty to teams that you once used to. If like players like Barry Sanders, he was a running back for the Lions. And the Lions really, I don't think they ever won a Super Bowl, at least that I know of in recent years. But Barry Sanders retired as a Lion. He didn't run to the 49ers or to Dallas in the early 90s whenever they were winning so many Super Bowls. He didn't run to them to get a Super Bowl ring. He was loyal to the team that drafted them and gave him a home. Even the loyalty of fans. Some are so loyal, they love them whether they win or lose. We love when they win. And there's something to brag about, something to hope for. I've been a Dallas Cowboy fan my whole life. And it's been tough since the early 90s to the mid-90s whenever they were winning Super Bowls, and they haven't won one since. Lots of hopes get dashed in the first game of the playoffs, and it seems like in recent years, if they make it to the playoffs. But through thick and thin, we still watch, or I still watch, and hope for the best. Now, I know we've been swayed or enticed, at least for me, by new players, whether it be Dax or whether it be Ezekiel Elliott. Hopefully, you know, one or both of these guys can help get us to a Super Bowl. Maybe this new coach. We as Arkansans, we hope for the Arkansas football coach, this new coach, that he can pull them together, can have a good recruitment class, and maybe have a few more wins, at least to get to a bowl game. Now, today I want to start a new series with you. And I'm looking forward to June 7th as we'll be starting our services back here on campus again. And we're going to be sending more information out to you of how and what will be a part of those services, what will be needed. We're also going to have online as well on June 7th. We'll still continue to do this because I know not everybody will be able to come back just yet. But I had this series planned before COVID-19 happened. And we're going to journey through the book of Galatians. This is a letter that Paul wrote to an area, more specific to an area of churches, not just one specific church. There are a few churches in Galatia, kind of like Faulkner County. We have different cities in the county and churches spread out throughout the county. And Paul's writing to them this letter that would be passed around to the different churches in that area. Now, Paul's dealing with some fair weather fans, or really fair weather Christians. Paul had come and he had preached there in Galatia. People accepted Christ as their Savior. They were trained. They were ordained as leaders in the church, started churches. They were getting them up and going. And Paul had gotten word that these Galatian churches, these new some new preachers had come to town after he had left, some new talent, right? They said they had more information about what it means to be a Christian, or really what to make them a true Christian, a better Christian. And what they were telling them that Paul, you know, yeah, Paul, he's okay. He had his heyday. He's not the greatest of all time, the greatest of all time apostles. But here's the thing. He didn't even come or he didn't even follow Jesus. He came after Jesus. He came later. And so, yes, he was saved and it was miraculous. It was interesting. And it was better than him persecuting the church. And he's teaching, he's starting churches like yours. But we're coming in now. We have something better. We have something more good stuff. And really what they were telling the church was lies. These guys were called Judaizers. And what they would do is they would tell Christians, especially Gentile Christians, like in Galatia, pretty much everybody's a Gentile, they're not Jewish. And so they would tell them that they need to adhere to the Jewish customs, the laws, all the ceremonies before they really become a Christian or a real Christian. And Paul's wanting to clear up this issue through his letter, through this letter to the Galatians. He wanted them to know that they had freedom in Christ, not to be bound back up with all those laws and all those rituals, all those rigors that the ceremonies had them go through. Because even for the Jewish people, it had become more duty than it became worship. So he wanted them to know that what he gave was the truth, and it is the truth that they could live by and live freely by. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Galatians chapter 1, and we're going to start with verses 1 through 9. We'll read that today and go through and see what those verses tell us. So it says, Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me, to the churches of Galatia, grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Verse number 6, he says, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you into the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another, but there are some who would trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. And we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches another gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this morning, and I thank you for your word. Lord, I pray that you'd help it to teach us. Lord, I know we're not in first century Galatia, but Lord, we are still dealing with that evil age that Paul writes about. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to be able to be wise and sift through what is truth, what is not truth, from what your word says. Lord, we love you and we thank you for everything you do. In Jesus' name, amen. So verse 1 says, Paul, an apostle. Well, what's an apostle? Well, it's what we see in the Bible and how it's defined. We see these apostles are usually somebody that followed after Jesus, as it's written in the Bible. But it's someone who's an ambassador. This word literally means to send or dispatch. So as they are dispatched, they have the authority, just as the head person is there. So Paul has the authority, just like Jesus Christ. If he was here, he's being sent by Jesus Christ. So he has the authority of Jesus Christ to teach. So Paul is an apostle of Jesus Christ. And that means biblically, in regards to the apostles, that they had weight and substance in regards to their ministry. One that has seen the risen Jesus. Now, Paul had seen the risen Jesus on the road to Damascus. Also, he was taught by Jesus. And we'll see that later in the book. But what is speculated by many scholars as to when Paul was given this instruction, the teaching that he was giving the churches in the letters that he wrote that are now in the Bible, that he was taught directly by Christ to have that information. Now, Paul being an ambassador for Christ, his job is to do and to live out what Christ would do and live. Paul says this in Philippians chapter 4, verse number 9. He says, the things which you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. Paul is claiming his apostleship is important because he's saying, you need to follow what I do because I'm following what Jesus did and what he taught. And so now Paul has these new teachers, these what we would call fair weather teachers come in. They're the new talent. They're the new guys. And they're saying, hey, we got something special. And Paul, you know, he's an afterthought. And so they're saying he's a bandwagon Christian himself. You know, he didn't follow Jesus when he was here. And then he jumps on. But Paul's letting him know that his apostleship is authentic. Look at what he writes next. In verse 1, it says, not of men. He goes, I'm an apostle, but not of men or through man. He's saying, there wasn't a search team. There wasn't a committee that was put together to put me in this place. And there really wasn't even a man that was said, all right, Paul, you're going to follow me now. You're going to take my place. You're going to be the apostle whenever I step down. That wasn't there. He goes on in verse number 1. It says, but it's through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. So it's Jesus that called Paul to be an apostle. Now, we had mentioned the road to Damascus. Paul was going to Damascus to persecute the church. He was actually heading there to shut them down. He wanted to stop this new movement that said the old way, what the Old Testament and all those laws and all the things that God had said before was wrong, and that, or not that it was wrong, that it was no longer the predominant thing. This, because Jesus came and fulfilled that. So he says it's no longer efficient or effective. So Paul instead stopped. He stopped in his tracks by Jesus. And he's converted right there on the road to Damascus and followed Jesus from that day forward. It was God's will for Paul to be an apostle, as it includes God the Father in his address. He's saying, one that gave Jesus the power to raise him from the dead, the power that's in Jesus because he is God, the one that has given me authority to be an apostle and to speak truth into your life. Then he talks about in verse 2, and all the brethren that are with me saying that, oh, my crew that's helped me in missionary journeys, ministering, church planning, organizing, training. And he says to the churches of Galatia. And as we mentioned earlier, that includes a few churches. To give you an idea of what that looks like, I've got a map right here that I want to show you. And you see kind of Galatia, you have Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, kind of in the south part. That's kind of the area that he is writing to. Verse 3, then he gives his address to them. He says, grace and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, we've discussed grace and peace before whenever we studied through the book of Philippians. But I want to explain why this is important in what Paul is writing to them. Grace is God's unmerited favor. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, it means that God gives us what we don't deserve. He's given us salvation. And that salvation is being, that word salvation means saved, and that we are saved from sin, saved from hell, and eternal destruction, and eternal separation from God. He gives us forgiveness for our sins. He gives us mercy in that grace, that unmerited favor. He gives us love, love that we're not worthy of to have because of the sin in our life. The sin that we sin against God, a holy God, the selfishness that we have to have it my way. The hatefulness, where we say, I hate the way that this has happened, or I hate their way over there, God's way. We have that hate in our life that God said, I want to forgive you, that I want to get it out of your life. Even the lust that we have for other people's stuff, the lust that we have for other people, maybe, not to be satisfied with what God's provided. This grace is getting all that love, all that mercy, all that forgiveness whenever we've done nothing for it. All we've done is selfishness, hatefulness, lust-filled hearts. So we get the good in spite of all of our bad. That's grace. And with that grace we receive, we can have peace. I know we would love some peace right now, right? Peace in our house with kids being there all the time. We're there all the time. Peace in our minds about who's right. The medical professionals over here or over there. The media, the president, Dr. Fauci. I'm not sure exactly how to say his name, or the CDC president, Robert Redfield. It would be great to have some peace about all this COVID-19 stuff, what's happening. But we can have peace. Not in those doctors or the president or even the media. It only comes through Jesus. The peace that Paul is speaking of is peace in our souls, that we can be no longer condemned if we know Jesus Christ as our Savior. Because Jesus is a sacrifice, or in his sacrifice, allows us to have that peace with God. Look at Romans chapter 5, verse number 10. It says, for if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. So what this verse is saying is that we were enemies of God. When we have all that hate and that lust and that selfishness in our life, we are enemies of God. We are against him because we're against what he's about. But because of Jesus and his death and what he did for us, we could be reconciled. That means we can be brought back into that right relationship with God and be saved by his life, which leads us to verse 5 of our text. Let's go to Galatians 1:5. It says, who gave himself for our sins? Now, Jesus gave his life for you and for me. Mark chapter 10, verse 45 says, even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. So Jesus came to serve, but he came to serve with his life, giving up his life for you and me, dying for you and for me, taking our place. But for what? Well, Galatians 1:5 says that he might deliver us from this present evil age. This is what Paul is concerned with, this evil age that we live within. Now, this will not go away until Jesus Christ comes back and reestablishes the new heaven and a new earth. We still have to deal with this evil age, this world that gives us temptations of all kinds, right? Distractions, even illusions. The illusion that our culture tells us that we're good and that we're okay. And that if you're good enough, then that's all right. That's all you need. Or the illusion that absolute truth is not real, that we don't have to believe this Bible because it's not absolutely true. It's an old archaic book. And our culture tells us that everything's relative. Relative to your situation, this is what truth is. Let's say like stealing or lying. Is it okay? Are those things okay? Are they always wrong? Or is okay whenever we need it or if it helps us? And so it's always relative. It's always subjective. But Jesus giving his life to deliver us from this evil age was according to the will of God in verse 4. Now verse 5, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now our job is to glorify God with our life and the way that we live it. And we're going to talk more about that in just a moment. But that at the end of this greeting, when you study and look at what Paul's writing, there's a lot there. He's not just saying, hey guys, how are you? There's some thought and reason in this greeting, in what he's saying about grace and peace and about Jesus Christ being our substitute, being our Savior. But also I want you to look at other letters. Usually when we went through Philippians, or if you read Thessalonians, or you go to Romans, usually in these opening parts, there's a thankfulness. There's a part where he says, I'm thankful. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. It says, we give thanks to God always for you, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God our Father. So we see that, man, Paul's like, I'm thankful for you guys. And here's how I am thankful for you, because of your faithfulness, your love. But here in Galatians, we don't see that. That part's missing. Now, some scholars say that this is one of the earlier letters that maybe he forgot or didn't do that yet. But I think, like with some other scholars, that Paul's upset with them. And they're not respecting him. They're not respecting, more importantly, the gospel that he gave, the good news, the information that he gave them that was sufficient. They're believing and practicing something different from these new teachers, these fair-weather teachers, and they're becoming fair weather Christians. So look at verse number 6. Paul says, I marvel. Now that marvel means astonished. He goes, I'm astonished that you are turning away so soon from him, God, who called you into the grace of Christ. You're believing a different gospel. Paul's saying, wow, that escalated quickly, right? These new guys come in and tell you they have something better, they have something new, and you take it. You believe it. And this turning away in the verse actually means deserting. They're these fair weather fans. They're like, oh, look, there's something better over there or over here. There's something newer, some secret information. Paul's saying, you're deserting God who called you. You're deserting God who loved you, who gave you the grace that we described, the grace of Christ. He's saying you've traded it in. And for what? A different kind of gospel? One that actually these Judaizers actually pull you back into legalism? He goes, these guys are Gentiles. They don't know the laws and the ceremonies and all the steps that were taken to follow God in the Old Testament. And so they're kind of like, hey, let's do this because maybe we're missing out on something, not realizing that they're actually binding themselves back up instead of being free in Christ. Paul says, you're following a different gospel. And he goes on to say, verse number 7, which is not another. And what that phrase means is that it's really not the gospel at all. There's no good news. It's actually old news. It's been done away with. Paul understands that it's not to come up with something on their own. Verse 7, he goes on to say, but there are some who would trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. This some are these Judaizers that came in that swoop in and say, hey, let me tell you something extra, something secret, some information that you're only going to hear from us. When you hear people say, we found something new, here's a new way to look at this, new teaching, this secret. Let me remind you what Solomon told us years and years ago in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse number 9. He says, that which has been is what will be, and that which is done is what will be done. And then the part I want you to get, there is nothing new under the sun. Folks, there is nothing new under the sun. It's all been done. It's here. It's how we operate with what's been given. For these Galatians, these Gentiles, this is new. It's different. They've been following idols and philosophies. And then Paul comes in and teaches them what God wants them to do. And then these new guys come in and they start causing trouble. That cause trouble actually means confused. And that's what they were doing. They were confusing them. Paul's saying they're trying to confuse you. And we can feel that right now for us with all the different media streams. If you watch any of the things that are happening with the coronavirus and what's happening, who to follow, it's confusing. It's overwhelming. And our culture and what it dictates is confusing. It conflicts with what this book says many times. Our culture, this world, will pervert this gospel, no different than these Judaizers did back in the first century. Our world today will say the gospel, this Jesus thing, is too narrow-minded. It's too strict. It doesn't allow for what I feel or what I like or what I think is right. This word pervert actually means to reverse, to change to the opposite. So Jesus came and lived and fulfilled the Old Testament law, so we didn't have to for salvation. Here's the thing, we couldn't. And so Jesus did it for us. And we live our life in him and for him, in the grace that he provides, that love, that favor that we get from God that we did nothing for, except to receive it with humility and with love. These guys are trying to get them, these Judaizers are trying to get them to go back to the law in the sense of jumping through all the hoops for God's love. Paul says, no, God took care of that through Jesus. You don't have to jump through these hoops. You really don't have to do all these things anymore because Jesus did it all. He took care of it. It's not to add to our salvation. These guys were saying you had to do this and then do that and then these other things, then you'll be a real Christian. And see, that's not what God wants us to do. Now, I've showed you this before, but I want to show it to you again. The concentric circles of when we have salvation, salvation is salvation by faith through grace alone. And so that's in the middle. If you add anything, whether it be baptism or the Bible version that you have or how you dress or church attendance, if you add any of those things into this center circle, you've cheapened what Christ has done for us. It's salvation by grace alone through faith in Jesus. None of these other things can add in. These are all works, and we don't need to do anything for our salvation. We don't need to add works to our salvation because Jesus did everything. Because if we do that, then like I said, we cheapen what Christ did on the cross. Now, it's good to have these things. It's good to be able to consider what kind of Bible we're reading, or we need to be baptized because it shows it's a public display of what Christ did in our life. But it is not required for salvation. Now, I love what Paul goes on to say in verse number 8. He says, but even if we, Paul includes himself, or he says, an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. So Paul's saying, even if it's me that comes back to you and says, hey, I got it wrong. Don't listen to me. He says, don't listen to an angel. Folks, that's what the Mormon church is about. An angel called Moroni told Joseph Smith where to find these golden tablets, which is where they get the Book of Mormon. That's a different gospel. And then what they say is we have the completed gospel now. But folks, let me tell you, it's not true. Everything that we need is right here. That is a fair weather faith. Say, I don't like what they're preaching over there. Or I don't like what they're doing over here. And so I'm going to make up my own. I'll start something new. Just like what Paul's telling us here. Just to make sure, he reiterates again in verse number 9. He says, before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches another gospel to you than what you've received, says, let him be accursed. Anyone, any group, any cult, any one person, a culture, even a church. Now today, we don't have Judaizers, so to speak, in our churches. Yes, there have been legalistic people in the past that have said you've got to, you know, you don't have facial hair, or don't have long hair, or wear these certain clothes to church. And I think you might have saw that if you, over the years, if you grew up in the church from maybe like the 1950s to the 1990s, there was this facade of Christianity of you looked the part, but Monday through Saturday, you were no different than anybody else. But on Sunday, you at least looked holy because you wore a nice jacket or you wore a tie or you wore a dress. But I was thinking about, we don't maybe deal with that so much, but how can we apply what Paul's talking about today in our time and in our culture? What would Paul say to us if he came to our church today? Sure, I know on a larger scale, there's this health and wealth prosperity gospel. And folks, that's not real. You cannot name it and claim it because what you might name is not for you to claim. If you had it, would you even use it in the right way? We would be like what James says, is that we ask for, but we ask with wrong motives. And as I was studying for this message, I was praying and thinking about what would Paul say that we might struggle with? How might we pervert the gospel? I think it comes through what is called cultural Christianity. And what I mean by this is that our culture dictates our Christianity, especially here in America. The American dream of having this life of ease and of prosperity and that we can consume whatever we want. I know I've heard, if you just become a Christian, then everything will get better. And then it doesn't. Whether it's physically, whether it's mentally, emotionally, or we start to come to church and we're like, okay, I'm going to go to church and then maybe I can get this job and then the job doesn't come through or the raise doesn't happen. Well, if I come to church, then maybe my spouse will stop being a jerk and then they don't. And then since it didn't work out, you quit. You quit church because it didn't go your way. It didn't fix what you wanted or worse, you quit on God. Now let me, can you be a Christian and not go to church? Yes, but I don't think you'll be an obedient Christian. You'll miss out on the fellowship that's so important. There are 30 commands in the Bible that you cannot do unless you are interacting with other Christians in a fellowship. And I think that's why we long to come back together as a church together, to encourage each other, to worship together in person. And we can think we should not have to suffer. We shouldn't have to endure all this pain or loss, or at least not right now. Not at this age, not at my age, I shouldn't have to deal with this. Not at this moment. You're like, really, God, now? Right now is whenever you want to let this happen? I heard a pastor say this recently. He says, God showed his love through a suffering Savior. And if he did that, God will show his love and grace through our suffering as well. Now, that's hard to hear. But folks, that's biblical truth. That is not what our culture wants to hear. And sometimes that is not what I want to hear. Suffering is no fun. It's difficult. But to hear something like that, to see the Bible says it, that it can help us embrace suffering as God allows it instead of resisting it. And that will speak into people's lives. As they see us living our faith for real through suffering. Many people today, young people, that maybe went to church or didn't go to church at all, they think, well, that was my parents' faith. But they never developed their own faith. And when they get into real-life situations, they start to question real life, and where will their faith be? And this is where maybe when they get out into that world and the college professor challenges their faith in God, how will they be able to answer? Maybe when your friends say you're not being tolerant of this lifestyle or that choice, what do you do? Do you retaliate? Do you argue? Or do you respond in love, in compassion, in action? Show them who you are by your faith. You and I have the opportunity to show our community Jesus through how we live and how we talk to those in our culture that are far from God. Jesus did the same thing with the woman at the well, the woman that was thrown down at her feet or at his feet whenever she was caught in adultery. Both of those incidents, Jesus responded with love. Now, did he speak truth? Absolutely. Yes, he did. He told the woman at the well, how you're living is not correct. But he took the time to love. He showed the gospel. Not just preached it, but he lived it. He showed it through his life and through his words and through his actions. And folks, we have the same opportunity. The opportunity to be able to share the gospel, the love of God, not to pervert it, not to make it something it's not. But we can be loyal. Not be a fair-weather Christian, but someone who is consistent in their words and in their actions. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is 1 John chapter 3, verse 18. It says, "Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions." We can be able to show others who Jesus is and what love is through how we behave and how we respond, how we act towards those who are far from God. I want to encourage you this week, think about how you're living, how you show people Jesus. Because you are doing that. If you're a Christ follower, you're showing them Jesus. Are you showing them the right Jesus? Are you being swayed by our culture? Are you being swayed by circumstances? I want you to think about that. Think about how you are living. And think about what Paul says right here. Are you perverting the gospel or are you furthering it? Helping others to see Jesus by your life and how you live. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this morning. Lord, I thank you for this time to be able to study, Lord, to go through this book, Lord, to be able to let it speak to us, Lord, 2,000 years later, as we still deal with maybe not the exact same problems, but still deal with this evil age. That is still there. And Lord, I pray that you would give us wisdom. I pray that you give us discernment and how to live for you. Lord, that we would not be swayed by our culture, that we would not be swayed by this new preacher or this new teaching, so to speak, whenever there's nothing new under the sun. We have your truth right here. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to live it. Live it each and every day, even in the hard times. Lord, we love you and we thank you for everything that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Hope you have a great day and we'll see you soon.
We trust the name of Jesus.